Allora devo cambiare l'ultima trasparenza per dire cose fantastiche di te, lo faccio, siccome non sarai.
Non ci sarò io. Ecco. Puoi anche parlare male di me.
No, male no. Male no, sciocchezze.
Okay, so welcome to the afternoon session. As you already know, Professor Cabré's flight was cancelled, so there will not be talk this afternoon, but Enrico Valdinoci will do the second of five lecture after Professor Vasquez, who is going to talk about nonlinear fractional parabolic equations problems in bounded domains. Please, Juan Luis.
First of all, let me thank the organizers for the kind invitation to this meeting. I'm very honored every time I come to Italy, which is like my second home country now after so many years. I was here many years ago. I will not tell you where, because it's embarrassing for me. But this one, one of the first activities I organized abroad from Spain was here. And so I'm very happy to come back to a place which has this international flavor. Let me just tell you that my name is Juan Luis Vasquez, so I am not Cabré. Yeah. And this is bad for you, but there is one point. I come from Madrid, and Madrid is probably the best football in Europe. So it is, and you're not so bad. Okay. This is more or less the outline of my lecture. This is a panorama of what I am doing with collaborators. And in fact, I had prepared a lecture with the last developments, and I think that this is not suitable. So I just changed a bit because the title was just the last line. But since it's easy today to get information once you get to know what is going on, let me just give you, out of 5 points, 4 which are not operators in bounded domains. And the idea is very simple to start with. This is a lecture that is based on a summer course I gave in Cetraro, Italy last year. And it contains what we did after this last year lecture series. So the idea is that the diffusion equation is a motivation that has been driving me in the world, in my research in mathematics, since you need a leitmotif. Partial differential equations are a big endeavor. There are so many aspects, and you need some driving force. Mine is diffusion. And diffusion describes how a continuous medium, for instance, a population, spreads out to occupy the available space. And then this is a physical concept, and mathematicians put into it mathematics in the sense of models, equations, and results. And in fact, the influence of mathematics is that we call now in the applied sciences diffusion the things that can be modeled by mathematical diffusion. So there is something called mathematical diffusion. And it applies to all kinds of things, fluids, chemicals, bacteria, animal populations. Of course, you know that part of these diffusion models are applied in the finance market. This is where many people get their jobs now. And the main origin of these things, which makes it very strong, is that the basis is a beautiful equation that everybody knows if you are in the business. And it has incredibly many properties, and you never stop learning about heat equation and what the heat equation does for you. And so this equation has had enormous influence in science, not only in PDEs. It's an equation that has a strong influence in stochastic processes, has a strong influence now in geometry, in the study of the evolution of manifolds, has an influence in physics, has an influence in the social sciences. And there are many things that you learn because the heat equation has taught you how things work. For instance, If you don't know mathematics, you don't understand that heat equation and the Gaussian profile are brother and sister. And then once you know, oh my, the Gaussian is the heat equation, then your life is different. And there are many other things like separation variables, Dirichlet forms, spectral analysis. And well, okay, so the idea is the heat equation in itself produces lots of mathematics. But are there any other equations? That's a point. There's this big community of people working on equations of the family. And this family is called in code, mathematical code, parabolic equations. So there is a huge kind of parabolic equations. Now, parabolic equations come in two main stripes, a linear and non-linear. The linear theory is studied in master courses. And what was very interesting for people in my generation is that after the work on fluids, particularly in calculus of variations, in the beginning of the 20th century, the mathematics was ready to tackle nonlinear diffusion problems modeled by nonlinear parabolic equations. Now, the beast that comes out of these investigations is this kind of general equation that if you are good enough, you can study and you write the book and that's it. And this was more or less proposed in 1962-63, that maybe the general equation is, instead of du with respect to t, take the dt of some function called the enthalpy. Instead of the Laplacian, separate the gradient here from the divergence here and put some nonlinear action once you have split the Laplacian in two. This Laplacian splitting is one of the most beautiful things that happened to nonlinear science. When you split the Laplacian in two, you can play with the two different things and put things in the middle. And this is the basic of much of progress in nonlinear diffusion. And then, of course, you can put lower order terms that I collect here as B of X, du, and du, one derivative. Now, this is the general problem. And the general problem, as Jim Sehring, who was my friend for years, told me, telling the old days, they had a hope that maybe with good luck they could write the book. The book is to be written, which is good news for you. So there is lots of progress done in this field, and they have the progress splits into nonlinear diffusion and reaction diffusion. If you are working on nonlinearities that are basically here, you are working on nonlinear diffusion. If you accept here that this is the Laplacian and you put the nonlinearities here, then you are working on reaction diffusion. Remember that reaction diffusion includes Navier-Stokes, so it's not so trivial. Okay, so next is that what you do. Since there are so many specific examples, you need to concentrate on details. And this was something that took like 10 years to people to realize that work on the general models was not very fruitful because you were saying, let's say, in American you say nonsense. Let's say blah, 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 it's okay, you get general spaces, general results, but no real progress about the dynamics of the basic models. It's not nonsense, it's a way of talking. It's not no disrespect for the people who are very abstract. It's the fact that if you want to know what really happens in the real models, you need to go to details. And this, once it was understood that this was not risk doing details, people, when I came to the field, were working on four important problems where the only difficulty was that instead of the Laplacian, they were using some nonlinear thing. And the four models were the Stefan model, Hillshaw model, porous medium model, and evolution pill Laplacian. And at the time, I met Luis Caffarelli, and this is more or less the story of my life in the neighborhood of this wonderful personality that you met last week. So he was doing essentially Stefan problem. He did incredible contributions, and also the non-parabolic problem that is called the obstacle problem, very closely related. And I was in one of these planetary systems doing porous medium and evolution pill Laplacian. And we were like close planets, under close surveillance by him. But we were doing well. So, and then there was another idea that I will not explore here, is that if you want to put the nonlinearity on the lower order term, there's this beautiful world of blow up that did incredible progress by exploring a very particular model, which is called the Fujita model, a scalar. There are still many problems open in vector, but if you go to the systems, please go to Navier-Stokes. Okay. So next is fractional diffusion. So for many years we were happy doing that, and then in 2007 I was spending some time with Luis in Texas, and he said, "Well, Luis, this time you are going to do fractional ablations." And I said, "No." And he said, "Yes." And this is how I said yes. It was so very easy. I mean, the conversation was relatively easy. I said, "Well, come for some asado home, and I will explain to you why you say yes." And the idea is saying yes to a new object that became part of the family. In fact, the object is, in most elementary form, the fractional heat equation, which is not new. It was known by people in probability, because there is a connection that probably you know, that if you work on PDEs, the evolution of a certain distribution of probability according to Brownian motion is represented by a master equation, blah, 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 and then you get the heat equation. Now, if you are now working on a stochastic process that has a certain properties of similarity, like Brownian motion, the other option is Levy flights, alpha stable processes. And they come in a family with the parameter. You go to the master equation, you make your calculations, and you get that instead of the heat equation, you get this equation. So people in probability knew that. So what do you have to do? Essentially, let's say, if you are a reasonable person, you say nothing, these people in probability are strong enough, they are doing it, that's okay. In fact, it's not so easy to read, if you are in PDEs, read probability. Stochastic processes is a complicated language, so you let it go. Now, Luis told me, listen, well, Luis, probability is very strong in doing linear problems, but there are these problems coming from geometry and physics which are heavily nonlinear, and PDEs is not very strong in doing these things. So there is a chance that PDEs will be stronger than probability in tackling some of the problems. Let's do it. And if they are strong enough, it's okay, we are friends. So the idea is doing these things. Now, the first thing you want to know, we are trying to do parabolic equations. What is the good definition of the fractional ablation? Probably you know that, but since this is a rather, I decided to do it very elementary, I will not probably collide with Enrico, so let me repeat by definitions. First definition is going to the people in harmonic analysis, and they tell you that you do Fourier in the whole space, and there is a symbol. And the symbol of the Laplacian is C squared, the minus Laplacian. The operator that has a nice symbol is minus Laplacian. Everybody knows that the positive operator in analysis is not the Laplacian. It's the minus Laplacian. Okay, and then you say the fractional operator should be going to the symbol and take a power between 0 and 1. Now, you can take any power, so in principle, the fractional operator can be defined not for fractions, for more than fractions, extrapolating to the whole range of exponents, which is very important to do equations of third or third and a half order, because the order of the number of derivatives of virtual derivatives is reflected on this exponent. Now, this is very good for linear analysis, but the point is that didn't want to do the linear analysis. So you say, listen, do you have any other thing in your storage? And the same people in harmonic analysis, there's a very strong group in my university related to Stein and to Pfefferman. They knew that you can invert the product in the Fourier space and make a convolution with the Fourier inverse of the symbol. Now, the Fourier inverse of the symbol is a tricky thing because it has a derivative that is n plus 2s. So it's not integrable. So you get not the, you get a singular integral that doesn't make any sense, and then you have to do something, and they knew what to do. They do, instead of a convolution, a modified convolution where you put ux minus uy upstairs. This is called a hypersingular integral. They knew how to do that. In physics, it's called renormalization, so the integral can be computed, and it really corresponds. So it's okay. Now, so you now know how to do these things integrating in the whole space. And this is a beautiful formula because it has, as Valdinocchi said, the kernel. So next thing for us is that this is too linear. And what these people in probability say is that they were not doing any of these things. They know that, because of course in probability they know everything about Fourier analysis, but they wanted to do Markov processes with transition probabilities. How do you model a discrete version of what I want to do? The idea is that you replace next neighbor interaction of the, on the computation of the Laplacian by interaction all over the place. And this is where you begin to learn what is a Levy process. There are several ways of looking at it, but one of them that is very important for me is that the interaction of a particle with a particle far away depends on an inverse power of the distance. Why an inverse power? Because it has the properties that I know I need to do symmetric and highly invariant operators. And when you do the powers and you know how to do it, the next step is take a student to do the non-powers. The student has to be good enough, of course. We are still looking for a student. So the idea is you take back. Now, how do you go from this stochastic process to the operator? Oh, this is very easy. It's the infinitesimal generator of the semigroup. So it's okay. Now, but this is not good enough because this is linear. And then there is an idea that came from geometry because Luis Cavarelli is a very good expert in minimal surfaces. So he knew what these people in geometry were doing. And he said, oh, there is an extension version of these things that comes from geometry that says that your manifold where you are working, R to the N, is the border manifold of a certain space that lives upstairs from you. This space is really the space where the state, the virtual state, works. And people who know hyperbolic geometry recognize immediately that the upper part is where the hyperbolic Laplacian sits, and this is the infinite horizon. And there is a boundary operator corresponding to this study. So there are manifolds that have a certain hyperbolic structure. Okay, forget hyperbolic. This is an idea from geometry. Now, how do you define the Laplacian, fractional Laplacian with extension? The first attempt is terrible because you go to these Graham's working whatever things, and this is what Alice Chance knows, and it's you make no progress. You have to study geometry, and it's too late for you. But there is another version for people in PDEs. You write the equation upstairs in the virtual space, the hyper, the half space upstairs. And it is a field equation that is, curiously enough, it's a Laplacian with weight, and the weight is vertical distance, which in hyperbolic space is the geodesic distance. So with respect to the hyperbolic structure, you get a distance here that comes from wherever. It is a distance. Then if you are in analysis, forget geometry. So there is a weight. And you solve the equation there, and then to define the Laplacian, so you first take a function up downstairs, you extend it normally, normal extension, but in the way that it has to satisfy this, the elliptic equation upstairs. And then you take this thing. You take this Neumann boundary condition with the weight. And the operator from Dirichlet to Neumann satisfies the Laplacian, not only for alpha equals 1, oh, there is a problem that there are two versions, the people who write minus Laplacian alpha halves and the people who write minus Laplacian s. So I use s between 0 and 1 and alpha halves between 0 and 2. So we have been introducing, it depends on Enrico, to introduce the notations that people respect, but people do whatever they want. So Enrico, do better. Okay, I'm using alpha in S. And so this is a way. Now, this is very good, because solving equations does not have to be linear. And taking boundary operator is okay. And maybe nonlinearity will sit downstairs. So this is something I can do. So much of the initial progress was done by doing extensions. And this is a very strong theory. Now, the construction of generalized of this extension was the thesis of Luis Silvestre, a guy who is very intelligent, and he was very lucky because he came at the right time to the right place, and he did a wonderful thesis. And then there are two people in my department who did these extensions and constructed the semi-group for general operators, more general than the Laplacian. And these people, I mentioned them, Stinga from Argentina and Torrea from Madrid. And now there is another version that comes immediately if you are doing operators that are positive. That is the fractional operators related to some Laplace transform with a weight. So if you integrate from zero to infinity, the solution of the heat equation with the Laplacian minus f, and you put the singular weight, you get the fractional Laplacian. And this is the semi-group approach. So now you have so many objects to play. My point in this talk is, which one of them is good to do boundary problems? Now let's go back. Okay, doing Fourier analysis in bounded domains looks a bit hopeless, unless you don't have anything else. I mean, if you are disperato totale, puoi farlo. But non siamo disperati. Second, doing integrals you can do. The problem is, but this is in the talk by Enrico, is where do you integrate if you are in a bounded domain? The X belongs to the bounded domain, and the Y. What do you do with people who live out of the border? So this is a problem that is very well known, even in politics, as a motivation. Or if the equation is satisfied inside, will you take into account the border or not? A standard diffusion does not jump. The probability says you never jump. You touch your next neighbor and push him. So in the end, you go to Trieste and there is a border there. And there is no way you can go to Slovenia without passing the border. Now, in nonlinear, then you do something like drones. You jump, and all of a sudden you find yourself in Ljubljana. What do you do if you are in Ljubljana? You come back? Do you report back? And this is what happens in information theory every moment when you do work on the telephone. You are in Trieste, but for internet there is no borders. The information for this talk came from talking to my friends in Warwick and Madrid and United States. So how much is the influence of people outside of my close community? This is what you have to decide. So there's a problem about if you are in an equation in a domain, will you take into account what happens outside? Or will you really solve the equation in the whole domain? And this is what we have been discussing for a long time. This is a discussion that we did in the parabolic setting, not in the elliptic. In the elliptic, the talk so Valdi Noci will do it. Let me see about these Levy processes. The Levy process was a big motivation to not to get lost in the analysis, because the people in probability know what you do with the particles that jump. And they know how to decide what to do with the particles. So different definitions will depend on the probabilistic interpretation. Now, there's another way. If you get another client that gets you the fractional Laplacian from another motivation, will this new client have a new Laplacian? And the answer is yes. Last week in Warwick, I was discussing with Christian Schmeiser from Vienna. And he was telling me that they do fractionals by as limits of kinetic, and they find a different definition of what to do with points beyond the border. So there's every client has a right to influence our mathematics. And now let me see the extension. And this is very interesting because there are two options for an extension for an operator in a bounded domain. And this was not understood by very intelligent people who were thinking another way. Suppose your bounded domain sits here, And you want to have an extension using this idea that my boundary behavior is like the life on the infinite horizon downstairs of a certain hyperbolic movement in the new dimension. So where is this hyperbolic movement? And people in geometry knew that the best idea was to consider this part of the horizon as the infinite horizon of a certain manifold that sits here. There is a manifold here, and this is the horizon. So the problem is, which kind of manifold tube are you thinking of using? And there are two options. You already know that because you are pretty smart. You are not doing siesta, which is what we do in Spain. For people who are not doing siesta, the first option is taking the whole space. No, this is the second, sorry. First option is taking a vertical cylinder, and then you say, oh my God, and what are the boundary conditions? Since I am a simple person coming from a simple place, I take boundary conditions zero here and zero here. So my extended boundary condition on the elliptic cylinder will be zero all the time. The first people who did that, and this way I'm telling you, I'm writing clearly, was Xavi Cabré, who should be speaking at this moment here. You see him? Hello, Xavi. Yeah, Xavi Cabré did that. Now, there is another option, which is, for many people in analysis, more natural, but it takes a time if you are not in analysis. I mean, you are in geometry, you don't see that. If you are in analysis, you see that very clearly. You have a function here, and by some method, you construct the Laplacian. By a formula. How do you do it when the function is defined here? Put u equals zero here. And of course, there are infinitely many possibilities of taking your manifold like this and putting here, zero here, and here is omega. It, depending on the cone you are using for your definition, I don't know if these cones have any interest, but in principle, for people in geometry, they are completely natural. Why not, right? So this is another definition, okay? So, and this is what we try to do. In fact, there are two basic definitions of extended, of fractional Laplacians on bounded manifolds, on bounded, sorry, bounded domains, and this is probably, I will not say much, I only need this for this talk, but since Enrico will be talking about that, let me say that we discussed a bit, and I don't know, Enrico, if we got the right names. People complain all the time because they're impossible. So this thing corresponds to what people in semigroups call the semigroup definition, and this is the spectral fractional Laplacian. This other version, flattening this, extending to zero, and applying standard formula, apply integral formula, which is really very much harmonic analysis. Some people say that we should call this the standard fractional Laplacian in bounded domain. But for people in geometry, it's not very natural, so we have these clients complaining. The name we put is restricted, and people have been complaining ever since. Okay, so let me tell you now what are the results. This is what we want to do. Let me tell you something about the models. We have been working since 2007, so in 10 years, with many people around, friendly people working a lot. There are lots of progress in this thing. I don't know how important it is, but there is progress in several directions. Instead of describing the theorems, which are well documented online, I will try to describe the directions. The first thing I will tell is the idea of the linear equation, where in principle we didn't do anything because it was supposed to be something standard known by people in probability. So Valdinocchi write a version of the fractional Laplacian good for students. And he published this in Bulletin of the Spanish Society for Applied Mathematics, I don't know why. And then after some years, they said, well, he went back to this problem and said, listen, if this is a linear equation and this is a Markov process, there is a transition probability, you get the fundamental solution, you integrate, and if you know the properties of the fundamental solution, you know everything. As he said, the problem of these fractional operators is that they don't get exponential decays. They get power decays. And this is what Blumenthal and Gattur in 1960 published a very beautiful paper, very short, telling that this generator of the fractional heat semigroup had a certain a priori estimate from above and below that was very nice. And it was true for every S from 0 to 1. In fact, if you put S equals 1, which is the 1 half Laplacian, the formula is exact. But if not, they can do it. And it relies on beautiful theorems on complex variables by Polya. So it's very old stuff recovered by them. And then the idea is that in a paper with Peral, Soria, and Barrios from my university, they proved something that was interesting for people in analysis. Suppose that you take data that are not integrable, but maybe constants, or maybe increasing. How many data can you solve by this fractional semigroup? The idea proved by Professor Wider many years ago was that in the heat equation you can get all the functions that grow exponentially. And the theorem for them was that they can grow only like a power. There is a power because there is a difference, in the parabolic case at least, that should be in the list. The powers of the growth power, maybe it was in your list. But for us it was very clear. No, we took this paper with my friends just to read because we like reading these papers that are well written. And we discovered with Matteo Bonforte and Yannick Siro, 1 year ago, we were in Baltimore doing that. We discovered that, in fact, we could give an if and only if characterization of the extended semigroup for the fractional heat equation. Suppose that the data are non-negative. If and only if the measure has this estimate, the growth estimate, there is a solution. The solution is unique in the sense that it has to be precise, certain strong, weak solutions. And then every solution has an initial datum of this type. Every initial datum of this type has a weak solution. In particular, measures are included for all effects. And this is a very interesting contribution that says that you can contribute something to the Wider theory. So we're happy with that. This was one of his 1 month work after studying the paper by Maldinocci. Okay, so next thing is that this is in archive. I think it's already published. When I wrote this transparency, it was in archive, and I said, archive is free. People keep asking you the paper and listen, it's in archive. And now let me tell you that the talk containing the results until summer of last year is documented in this thing that you can read. I put it today on my webpage, really easy to access. You go to CIMECORS, and where it says lectures, click. I did my clicking because I'm very slow and it works. So let me tell you what is the nonlinear fractional diffusion. The point of these models is that there is a beautiful coincidence between the motivation that comes from people who know what they are doing and the theory that comes later. All of this is La De Giorgi. And this is beautiful because, I mean, this kind of miracle happens in the best of worlds. We live in a very nice world where motivation goes along with lots of work in the middle and a beautiful theory in the end. So the first model we did, this is what I did in 2007, invited cordially by Luis Caffarelli. Remember this? I'm not going to do it. Yes, you are going to do it. So this model is that says, listen, Juan Luis, there is this conservation law that probably you remember because we have been working for 10 years. And then in porous medium, U is the density and V is the velocity. And you are transporting with a velocity that depends, that is a gradient of a potential, so it's a viscous flow. And the potential is, this law is called Darcy law, and the potential is called in Darcy law pressure, but no, the name is not important. So now you have a potential flow, and the only point you have to put into this model is what is the choice of potential. In the typical motivation for porous medium flows, the potential is a function of the pressure, because at the beginning it was a model for gases in compressible layers or for gas layers underground. It was the oil industry. The simplest model was for gases, not for naphtha. So there was a pressure, this is called the isobaric approximation, and you get the model. And then it was also got by Businesky in the study of underground infiltration, which is very important applications. So this is it, and we are not going to do that, because if you put V gradient P and P more or less U, you get the porous medium. And this, we already have done that, believe me. I'm not going to tell you, but it was a very successful life. Okay, so that was the idea. The idea is adapting this modeling from, this was people in the statistical mechanics community that came to Lewis with this idea. In this, in some of the models in statistical mechanics and now in information theory, long-range interactions are very important because of whatever, intermediate asymptotics. And you cannot say that the pressure that is the agent of your movement is just proportional to you. In fact, people from very far away are pressuring you. This guy who calls from Seoul, South Korea, telling you, Juan Luis, are you going to mention me? This is pressure, right? I mean, it's only one pressure from very far away. Maybe he doesn't listen, but he can make a pressure on me by just sending me an email. This is very important information theory. So people knew that, and they were doing models of interaction where the pressure is the agent, but the pressure comes from very far away. Now, and then the simplest idea, was taken from chemotaxis. The agents of pressures are a certain Ries potentials or Newton potentials. Instead of Newton, we take Ries, and in this case, Ries operator is the inverse of the Laplacian, and you get fractional Ries operators, which are the Laplacian minus S. They have beautiful kernels, and all of a sudden you realize, so these brothers Ries knew in 1930 everything. In fact, they didn't know, because they knew the Ries operator, but they didn't know the fractional heat equation. Probability was not developed. But they knew these kernels and they studied them. So in some sense, the Sobolev spaces were more or less in the beginning. They had these operators as motivation. So you have this equation. This is my equation. It looks a bit like a chemotaxis equation, right? With only one term. My term is diffusive. You can take aggregation pressures or diffusive pressures. Mine is in the way of diffusion. Can you change it? Of course, it becomes ill-posed unless you put another diffusion, right? This is coming in José Antonio's talks. But in 2007, we didn't know how to manipulate the attractions. We did diffusions. And we prepared a bit the machinery. Okay, now you put, if you want to impress people, you write the equation in this way. Really very impressive for me. But it has to be for impressionable people, not for you. So you put initial conditions and you go. And the idea is that you know that there are many, many works on fractional Laplacians for elliptic equations, and I'm not going to say that because there's the talks by Baldinocci here. And then I also say that what we were doing about bounded domains with bounded regularity had been done recently, some previous results that were needed for us by Xavier Rosoton, who is now in Zurich. And so let me see, okay. And the modeling. You are probably not very interested in modeling. I only say about the modeling because people want to be sure. There was a modeling dislocation by Biller, Kars, Monod, that works in one dimension. And they did a very careful analysis of the equation in one dimension, with the equation that I call Caffarelli equation. But in several dimensions, this location is not that. You cannot go from one dimension to three dimensions and you say the physical model is the same. Normally, it is not. So this location in three dimensions has nothing to do. And they didn't do the theory in several dimensions. So it is in one dimension it was done. And the model from the people in statistical mechanics, where these people, Jacomin and Leibovitz, they proposed this very general model. This is my U, this is U again, this is a coefficient of diffusivity, and this is, as you say, if you define the free energy, the operator, the inverse operator is the functional derivative in the sense of calculus of variations, and you put it here, whatever. So then all of a sudden you realize that you are doing calculus of variations, which is amazing. I mean, you don't sleep for several nights. I talked to Luigi Ambrosio, and he said, oh, Luis, be quiet. There's no problem. Calculus of variations is okay. So can you use operators that are not Riesz operators? Why not use Bessel operators, which are the inverses of this thing? And this is an interesting news for the students, because the solutions in some sense are the same or better, in some other senses are not the same, because the operator doesn't have the scaling. So you have to do things to recover the scaling in the limit. And let me jump on this line and let me tell you what we did as a program. And let me give you an idea what was the approach of our work that we did of 4 years with Luis to try to settle mathematically this Cauchy problem. First thing you want to do is getting weak solutions in some sense that can be integrated, because you want to do some calculus of variations. So you want to have an energy. If they are too weak, you will not be able to do any computation of no energies, no nothing. So we constructed weak energy solutions. And this, since we were, I mean, I was in Madrid, he's in Texas, he's busy. It took 4 years to publish this thing. And then the journal was terrible to us. The second thing is that we produced the asymptotic analysis of what the solutions do. And they converge to a certain statistical equilibrium that is not the Gaussian. And it's not the P that we found in the linear case. It's a new thing that is the solution. How do you do these things? I mean, you have to do some calculus of variations. And you find that the profile of this evolution in time tends to a certain thing, like it looks up in first approximation like Gaussian, but it has compact support. And this is what we call Barenblatt fractional solution, because of our friend Barenblatt. And then once more or less the space was clear, Luis says, okay, let's stop monkeying around. Let's prove regularity. And we say, well, how do we do it? Yeah, well, this is the Georgi. The Georgi do everything. And if you know, according to Luis, if you know the Georgi, then you know that solutions in L1 are in L2. And solutions in L2 are in L infinity. And solutions in L infinity are C alpha. And solutions in C alpha, then you come to the talk by Enrico, are in C alpha. They refuse to be better because they have an obstruction, which is the C alpha regularity of even the best of the profiles of S harmonic functions try to be C alpha in the border. There's nothing you can do. I mean, if you are very naive and you are in your country alone, you prove C alpha implies C1, C1 implies C2, and you try to publish it. Be careful. We didn't do that because we knew that there was this thing. Okay, so now let me tell you, you can take the limits when S equals 0 or when S tends to 1. Remember that my equation is UT equals divergence of U gradient of minus Laplacian minus S of U. If S goes to 0, this is porous medium equation. If S tends to 1, it's a funny equation that says gradient of U gradient of Newton potential of U. And this goes gradient U gradient P minus U square. Because the minus Laplacian, I mean, S equals 1 is the minus Laplacian, so it's the Newton potential. The Laplacian of the Newton potential is again the function with the minus. And this is a very strange equation. In principle, if you are in Pisa, it's not so strange, because this is the model for superfluidity that Luigi and Savare and Serfati were working on. And Serfati came to Barcelona, was there one day that we were trying to drink some beer. She said, I have this problem that is very difficult. I said, no, come on, my problem is very difficult. Look at that, it looks like the same. So we combined. This is a curious equation for S equals 1, which is going really back, no Hölder continuity. So the limit of the former equations that are parabolic, a bit parabolic, is an equation that is not at all parabolic and produces vortices. It's a vortex equation. It's a very beautiful coincidence of talking to people about things that are not football. Then I wrote this thing that you can find in this Abel. In fact, I wrote it in 2010 because the results were already there in 2010. And then we tried to do this thing that José Antonio does a lot, Carrillo, that is proving convergence to the profile with exponential rates, which implies knowing a lot about energies and entropies. And we did it in one dimension. We don't know how to do it in more than one dimension. So the connection of these problems coming from statistical mechanics with analysis goes sometimes through functional inequalities. The functional inequalities are in some cases new. And this is new because it's interesting. You know which is the functional inequality that you like to be true. So you try to prove it. Among the thousands and millions of possible functional inequalities, there is one that you really like to prove. And this is a beautiful motivation because normally they are right, they are true. And you find interesting, I mean, we call them interesting if we wanted to know. And then they are not interested. Okay, so this is it. I will just give you an idea of how we did these things because it's interesting. Since the equation is not linear, we cannot use harmonic analysis. Representation is not true. It can be true in a lemma, by freezing the rest of the operator. But the basic ideas have to be a priori estimates and compactness. The a priori estimates that come from physics is conservation of mass, conservation of some powers, and decay of these powers that produce something that is called the rate of decay or dissipation. And your dissipation has derivatives. So it is the way you control derivatives and you get compactness. So if you don't get dissipation, your game is not very interesting. Now, this is calculation that I always do because I mean, you know, I know, because I like to do these things. This is a computation I did on the blackboard with Lewis when we discovered that the Boltzmann entropy is very good for us. Let me do that. You do ut log u plus u ut over u dx. But this in this go and this is zero because of conservation of mass. And then you say, so the dissipation of the Boltzmann entropy is log u gradient of u gradient. Let me call k the Grace kernel. But this is minus gradient u, no, sorry, gradient u over u, u gradient k of u. And this is where you do this thing that we do in Spain. Nyak, nyak. Very important. It plays a role in our lives. Nyak, nyak. And then you have minus gradient u, gradient of k of u. And believe me, this is a very beautiful operator because k is a Riesz operator that is k one half square. And this is symmetric. So you can put gradient of k one half, gradient of k one half, and this is the dissipation. Gradient k one half u squared. So you dissipate. And the dissipation has derivatives, so it's compact. You say, wow. That's it. So this is a beautiful computation. Now, since we knew that this k one half that I call h in the transparencies, I call it h, just to put a name. H is half potential, plays a role. I say, let's dissipate the half potential. Because we were looking for this object, people in porous medium theory know that this object is a beautiful dissipation for the entropy of porous medium, the famous Regni entropy. So if you dissipate the half potential, you find a beautiful thing with derivatives also. And these two things give you compactness and you pass to the limit. And then we wanted to prove the rest of the theory, which is approximation, existence, compactness, and you need functional spaces to control these products, these dissipations. These dissipations are funny derivatives because they are weighted, right? This thing is weighted by you, which is bad. Bad, it is not, I mean, it's, so you have to do something about functional equations. And then this is what we did. Let me tell you just, this is the calculation. The order, in order to understand these integrals, you do what you do in heat equation. Multiply by f of u and integrate f of u, the ut is capital F of u derivative with respect to time. So if you multiply by a certain function f of u, f small f of u, and you integrate ut f of u, you get this, this derivative between later and before. This is typical of heat equation when you put a power. Nothing new. Now, the problem is, what is the chaos in the second half? Now, you have a minus gradient of f of u. There I had put log of u. Now I am putting f of u. Gradient of u, u gradient p. But then this u does nyak-nyak. So I do this stupid trick, h prime is equals u f prime u, so this is the gradient of h of u. And then I have this thing, but I remember doing tricks with half Laplacians. This thing looks terrible, but if you isolate it here, this thing is a bilinear form on some Dirichlet space yet to be discovered. But this bilinear space, after several lines of computations, is just this thing. But this thing, if you compute a bit again, which is as here, is just this thing. These derivatives, you put them here, and you use the famous renormalization. And this is the Gallardo norm on fractional space. So you are dissipating the Gallardo norm. And then you are in business. Your life is better, and the paper finishes. I mean, if you don't get these beautiful coincidences and you know how, I mean, your functional spaces, you still survive. Part of the computations are done in spaces that are not so evident. You need an expert to guide you, for instance, Bessel spaces, because you are integrating, it's complicated. In this case, it's so beautiful and simple. And this is it. So then you prove that this bilinear, the dissipation of a certain energy was in bilinear form that represented Gallardo energy, so you have compactness. And then how do you use the Georgi method? I will not tell you because I have 10 minutes to produce some more evidence of what we did. This is additional in recent work where I quote several persons who have been working with us. And I will not read the names because I'm a bit late. Just the information will be available and you can talk to them. Stan and Tesso are my students. Lizzini, Mainini and Segatti are in Pavia. And then there are many open questions. For instance, what about uniqueness? We have methods that are very good in entropies, but in unique diseases, it is not easy, we don't know how to do it. In one dimension, there are tricks in one dimension that allow you to prove uniqueness, because you can use viscosity solutions. In several dimensions, we were not able. So there's an open problem. But there is a group of Chinese people, Zhu Xiao and Chen. They proved small-time uniqueness for solutions that are very nice until they begin to be C alpha. For these Chinese people, C alpha is a singularity. So a small time until you find the real beast. But this is okay. And the spaces are best of spaces. And we are working on numerical studies. So let me tell you model two. And this is, model two is another possibility of doing porous medium non-linearities with fractional Laplacians. And we didn't do much because the other model was work intensive. And on the other hand, we didn't have many people motivating us to do it. It's these things in analysis that you know that you have to do it, but since there is no motivation and you are a member of a group that is known, you do not risk. So we have done some calculations on the back of the some pages, and we are keeping it. And then once I was in Paris, and I discovered that Stefan Olla and his group, Milton Jara from Singimpa in Brazil, were doing statistical mechanics approximations to mean field equations, and they found fractional Laplacians in the linear and in the nonlinear case through a branching process. And then we said, okay, let's take back the notes. And we did make a program with my collaborators, the Pablo Quiroz and Ana Rodriguez. And we produced, in this case, the equation had no difficulties in the sense of, I mean, you have to find which is the fractional spaces. But this equation, that is the second model, has uniqueness, contraction, everything that you want in this world, maximum principle. So it really gets into the book. It's a lot of work, and you do it by extensions, the Caffarelli-Sylvester extensions all the time. And we published two papers that were very well accepted, advances in communications, more or less at the same time, because we have been doing the computations. And then there was a big problem in this model of getting the regularity theory. And this is where, before the regularity theory, I was doing asymptotic analysis because we didn't know how to construct the asymptotic profiles, the Barenblatt solutions. And now, the Barenblatt solutions in model one are like this. In model two, are like this. So one of the models, porous medium wins, and another model, fractional diffusion wins. And now the question for you, if you have been listening to Enrico, is how much is this distance? Well, it will move, but it's finite. And what is the behavior here? And then you discover it's 1 over x, and then you say, is it the elliptic behavior or not? And then you look at this number. It is. Okay? It doesn't see the nonlinearity. The nonlinearity is so far away, it's influencing it in the formation of the tail. But really, far away in the far field, when the fractional diffusion has already won, forgets about UM. Real beast. It's real victory. Real win. So this is what we prove with my students, and this is important because we settled the discussion about compact support. Porous medium equations with fractional diffusion produce compact support. Model one, yes. Model two, no. Okay? And this is important. And you have to use the techniques of asymptotic analysis, rather elliptic. And this is a good point to finish my talk, because at the time, when we did asymptotic analysis, we discovered that this was related to elliptic estimates. And I have been doing with my collaborator, Matteo Bonforte, an Italian that now is more or less Spaniard, has been there more than 10 years, and he has been working with me on these things, and we began to do quantitative, let's say, the what we call the Italian stuff. Quantitative estimates and qualitative. Qualitative and quantitative. Quantitative is my style. And then we did Harnack inequalities based on the idea that this equation is positive. It has to structure. And remember that since it has decay, Harnack had to be related to a certain weight. If you don't put the weight, you cannot have Harnack, of course, because you have to take into account what happens very far away. And then we did this, and then we started a collaboration about doing the estimates. So we did this paper with Bonforte on quantitative positivity and Harnack inequalities for this porous medium equation with no free boundaries in M larger than 1 and in M less than 1. Then we decided that maybe people wanted to know what happens if there are no powers. So there are two ways. One of them is changing the fractional Laplacian to more general operator, like Foldinocchi says. Another one is changing the UM to another power. The idea of changing into another power was done by these old people, Pablo, Quirós, and Rodriguez. And there's a paper to appear in Journal of European Mathematical Society. It's already online. It took them 2 years to put it online. And then, once we got regularity for this problem, Bonforte, Figali, and Rosoton proved C-alpha regularity of solutions in bounded domains and up to the boundary. And this was made me very happy because, I mean, oh, these guys in Texas were working on our paper. Oh, my God, it's great. Okay. And then we did symmetrization. We were, I mean, completely crazy. KPP, things work. Numerics is not so difficult. And then we discussed the question of putting powers here to see at which moment, at which critical moment, you pass from finite propagation to infinite propagation. I mentioned this because this is the work of Diana Stang and Teso. It took them like 2 years, with my help, of course. And then we have now settled the question. We know when propagation wins and when infinite propagation wins. And let me just tell you that you can do other things like P-Laplacians, which people know what they are. This is something, it's very flexible. In fact, the last thing I discovered is that once you can do this, the people in chemotaxis are trying to use these fractionals and powers of the U and porous medium powers to do different approaches to chemotaxis. So the machinery is very flexible. And now let me tell you just a bit. Oh, what happened here? Oh, no, it's okay. Let me just, if I have 2 minutes, let me tell you just what happens. Recalling the last thing we did with Matteo, Yannick, and then with Alessio. So we have these operators on bounded domains. And then the idea is that there is some green function and you construct the solutions. But the point is, what is the fractional operator in a bounded domain? So that's just a memory of what we have done. First idea is you take what we call restricted. It is a bounded domain, U is extended by zero, and then you take the fractional Laplacian by the hypersingular integral, no matter what. And never calculate outside. Thanks, Valdinocchi, for pointing it, that the equation is satisfied inside. Outside, nobody told the equation to satisfy anything. So it can be very wild. I mean, the people who talk to you from, I don't know, Korea or Spain, at impossible hours, they don't have any equations to satisfy with you because they are in their country. So this is a problem. We are thinking about controlling an equation in your domain, not outside. Next thing, in this case, this fractional Laplacian is a different object in the sense that it has eigenfunctions and eigenvalues that are discrete, but not the same as the Laplacian. And they have this C alpha regularity on the boundary. Which is the other guy? The other guy, oh no, and then they have a green function for the inverse operator that has this curious thing that the people in probability like. Powers of the distance that make some weighted singularity at the boundary. So people in probability knew that very well, that there are weighted singularity at the boundary. Second thing, the spectral thing. Spectral thing, you define things by spectral analysis of the heat equation. Take the eigenvalues, eigenfunctions, keep the eigenfunctions and put eigenvalues to a power. So the eigenfunctions are the same. And the eigenvalues are powers, so the operator is not the same. And the boundary regularity, it's already in Enrico's talk, is linear, not like us. So there is one operator that is good, another operator that is new. Are there many other operators? You can find many other operators. Once you discover that there are two possibilities, you can play with them. And we published, in fact, this is the green function estimates. There is another one that comes, a mixture of both, that comes in probability. It's called the sensor fractional, And let me tell you that we have three models. The references in the literature by probabilists are there. Bogdan, Berti, Cheng, Kim, and Song. And these are our papers. The last work is done by us, Bonforte, Figali, and Vasquez. It has been explained on Friday or last week by Matteo Bonforte in the symposium that we organize in Warwick, where I am now, in which is called Non-Local Equations and Fractional Diffusion. So if you want to know what are the theorems that we prove about the nonlinear semigroup evolution for these operators on about the domain, you can get this thing and read it. I have a copy myself, but you just ask my collaborator, Matteo Bonforte. And I thank you very much.